Welcome, everyone. I'm thrilled to be here today. I'm getting with it. It's 101 today. Right now, it's probably about 98. It was a pretty blistering day. I'm in linen shirt and my new board shorts, and it's like, okay, I'm with it. I'm getting with it, and we need to do this as the surreal nature of what's going on in the world, as that continues to develop, we simply need to make the right adjustments that we've prepared to make. That's all. So I'm right in the flow of the whole situation right now, very much so. So we meet today in a spirit of relaxed calm and humor and confidence. We are not I'm not lagging behind or in all sorts of trouble. I think I need to catch up. No, I'm right where I need to be, absolutely. And so we are here together to just hang out in this ambience, as I just adjust this a little bit here and there, just tweaking this, to hang out in this ambience and enjoy the ambience. And above all else, what we want is a feeling of relaxed confidence. We don't want to get all tightened up at this point. Relaxed confidence. I'm very confident right now. In all ways, everything is going splendidly for me. The right practices, the right focus, the right discipline. Just, you know, the whole ball of wax is just great. It's just great. And yes, I'm aware of the impending stuff and all that, but I feel very confident that we will give that a wide berth, that's for sure. No trouble at all. I was working out today. I got the message. The Holy Spirit gave me this feedback. I said, it was just basically saying, first it said, cool it for a little while. And then it also said, you know, do the exercises, but not so much at one time. Break it up into three different morning, afternoon, and evening. And that, so that won't overstrain you. Then rest in between and give your body a chance to recover. It's like you get into anything. At first, you might be overenthusiastic, which I was, and I got too tired. And that hit me so hard. But now I can feel really tired afterwards. But then the body is bouncing back better now. And it's really a whole body strength type of situations. Different type of exercise. Very, very, it hits the body in a different way. But this is a real, you know, pragmatic type of exercising. It's putting the weight over here and then over here and over here and twisting your body like this, so you're holding the weight and then you have to pull it back over here, and then this weight's over here and you got to pull it back over here, and it's awkward. There's awkwardness involved. You have to have the strength to handle awkwardness. Okay, so this is really important. The great surfer Laird Hamilton, in his workouts, he stresses, he says, look, you need to, the body keeps adapting to what you're doing, and then it says, okay, I've got it, but it fixates on it, it just has that, and you can be, and you, what you need is you need to keep changing your exercise routine, and keep emphasizing, putting yourself off balance, and in you know, positions that you're not used to, and then exercising to gain poise and balance and strength in those positions and transitioning to other positions. He says that's the real workout. That's the right, and I agree. I mean, he's a pretty good example of somebody who is physically fit in real life situations, riding those massive waves and tackling new types of styles of surfing. He's got some hydroplane thing where he's like a ski, and then he's up higher than that. Somehow, I don't know how he's doing it, but it's pretty doggone amazing. It's very risky stuff he does, but he's in great shape. So he feels he's able to take it on. Amazing. So this is just in a little way. Here spiritually, we keep stressing ourselves, working out in ways that help us become stronger and stronger and stronger, pragmatically, practically. As we go forward here, very important to do that. So there's physical workouts and there's spiritual workouts, and both are important. Spiritual is more important, but if you do some physical workouts, that can be helpful too. It tends to bring a little bit of confidence to the table, as long as we don't get overconfident that way and start daredeviling and challenging ourselves like daredevils. We don't want to do that. So good news all around here. There's so much good news, it's hard to know even what to say, actually. Super positive news all around. And I love the hot weather. As soon as it gets 100 or more, I'm happy. So, oh, this is great, wonderful. What a glorious day it is. It's just everything's so calm and still, and just everything seems to be relaxed and quiet under the heat, this kind of heat. If it goes, hits 100, everything feels different, doesn't it? Vegetation, everything just says, oh, I'm just going to meditate for a while. I'm not going to exert a bunch of, you know, effort towards determinacy. I feel very indeterminate. Everyone sort of lapses into this indeterminacy, which is great, which is reality. Reality is completely indeterminate, cannot be defined at all. And the now is perfectly indeterminate. That's why it lasts forever. That's why you can't leave the now, because you can never be defined what it is you're leaving. Right? Yeah. The now is all powerful. Power of now. Gee, that's it could be a good name for a book, huh? Gah. Eckhart beat us to it. But the power of now, it's all powerful, because it's indeterminate, completely indeterminate. Reality is completely indeterminate. This is the 19th hole, which is being the place we go when we have graduated, where we finished, where we can relax now, in a relaxed ambience. We're not still like the challenge of the golf course. It gets into our heads so badly, doesn't it? But now we're done with the golf course, and now we're relaxing here and enjoying, and preparing to smoothly glide in the now. Smoothly glide in the now. So we're just sitting outside in this heat. Yeah, why waste such a beautiful day inside? You know, shivering in the air conditioning. Get out and melt a little bit. Just melt a little bit. Become indeterminate. Just allow yourself to sit in the pool. Just relax in the pool. We're relaxing in the pool of indeterminacy. I've got my swim trunks on. Relax in the pool of indeterminacy. Yeah, absolutely. Is there such a thing as a pool shirt? I don't know. Maybe I need to get it. I don't know what that would be. but we're shifting the vibe here to one of very relaxed, hanging out at the pool. Some of us are just kind of relaxing in the pool of indeterminacy. And we alternate. We do our workouts, our spiritual workouts, absolutely. And then we relax for a while. Sit in the whirlpool. Just sit in the whirlpool for an hour, right? We're not working on determinacy. God is not working on determinacy. Only the ego is screaming about determinacy. You've got to work on it. Your identity depends upon it. No, the ego's identity depends upon it. The ego's not an identity, but it's the attempt to construct a determinate identity. So the ego says, well, I'll never be if you don't do this. I will never be born. Well, you're right. Nothing is never born. That's right. That's just how it is. Determinacy is never born. There is no determinacy. So this is just a silly wish, actually. That we've tried to put words in its mouth as if it's very important. My swing's good, very good, very very effortlessly powerful. I don't need to go to the golf course. I was saying maybe I should go to the golf course today. The Holy Spirit said no. I asked Longchamp. I said no. Work out. Keep working out. Okay, fine. I don't need to. I can tell just from the sound of the golf club and the swing where I end up. Just I can tell. Oh, this is good. This is good. This is very different. The swing is very different now. And I did realize that there's something I do have to work on going forward. So I will keep working out, getting stronger. Which is the power fade, power fade. And yes, we're talking spiritual talk here. The power fade is the pro shot, the go-to shot. For instance, Jack Nicklaus. I mean, somebody had to have this power fade, but you have to be powerful to hit the power fade. Otherwise, you lose too much distance. You have to really be able to hammer it out there, and then let it drift back to the right. You start out on the left, let it drift back into the right, and it goes in the fairway and rolls out. And what happens, you get older, you lose your power, and then you start trying to compensate, and you try to hit a draw, or hit it straight, or draw to get more yardage, and that messes up everything. It messes up everything. It's too difficult. Hurts your back, all this kind of stuff. The power fade, I used to have a power fade when I was young. Could hit the heck out of the ball. It was a lovely shot, just loved it. But I haven't hit one in a long time, because I haven't had the power to do so. It's just amazing. I got away from it. I can't remember the last time I had a really good power fade. Isn't that extraordinary? And I realized it's time to get back to the power fade. And so I'm making myself stronger and stronger. And the swing is very pro-ish in terms of how I'm doing it. And you hear the club, and it's got the sound of a pro sound. You can, when you go to a golf tournament, you listen to the pros, you listen to the sound of their golf club. Just listen to the sound it makes and the contact with it. But the whoosh. And it's got this beautiful sound to it. And when I'm swinging right now, I got the sound. The sound is there. It's really interesting. It's very, very interesting. There's a smoothness to the acceleration and a whippiness, smooth whippiness. That everything is smooth and just right, and it has a certain sound to it. So I said, I don't need to go to a golf course. I know the swing is good and getting better. So I don't need a golf course to validate that. All a golf course does is mess you up, actually. It really does. The less I golf, the better I get. Like, we don't need the world to validate our progress, actually, spiritual progress. We know. If we are practicing in a certain way, we know we're making progress. We know we're getting stronger. So I try not to test it out, you know, around people, and try to push things in terms of, I wonder if I can, you know, handle it in this situation or that situation. That's like going out on a golf course. Can I handle it on a golf course or not? Actually, you get diminishing returns. You lose your confidence a lot. And ultimately, what we're going for is abidance. So it's to stabilize abidance. And a lot of these great meditators, they didn't go out. They just stayed in caves. They didn't go into the world and say, let's see if I can handle abidance here in the world or something like that. They got it, so they know that they have it. But just sitting in a cave, and they say, well, okay, now I know I have it. So now I can go out in the world and do what I need to do. I'd say it's easier that way. It's easier. You don't get run down. So my golf game gets better and better the more I don't play. And when I play, it gets worse. This is what I discovered throughout my life. You think that you can play your way into good golf, you get worse. Because the bad shots multiply, the confusion, the frustration, and the compensation starts coming in. You start experimenting, doing stuff you shouldn't do. You get tired, you start losing your fitness. And before too long, your swing and your game is a mess. It really is. It even gets to the pros. They play so much, it wears them down, and they get into bad habits, all this stuff. Sometimes the best pros all take breaks and don't play. They don't play for 3 or 4 weeks. Just, I haven't even picked up a club. They let all the bad thoughts just disappear. They get back in shape. They're fresh, ready to go, and then, wow, they play great after that. This is one of the secrets. So actually, look into this. It's true. I'm telling you it's true, because I followed golf, you know, most of my life for 40 plus years, and I know. There's a guy named Bruce Litsky who only played the certain second half of the season, or the Southern Tour, the certain tournaments, Texas swing, he played those. The rest of the time, he didn't even pick up a club. I mean, for 6 months, 8 months of the year, he never even picked up a golf club. He was just doing other stuff. And then when it came time to play these certain tournaments, he'd pick up his golf clubs, he'd practice a little bit, and he'd come out and he'd just play great. It was just amazing, amazed everybody. Bruce Litsky. The idea is that, well, we have to constantly play golf. No. It starts getting into your head. Oh, why did I miss that putt? I need to do something differently. A lot of scar tissue can happen. So I tend to just not put myself in challenging situations socially. Avoid that. Avoid it. Because I said, look, once I've got it, I've got it. So why not just do what is the fastest way to really get it, instead of trying to, you know, show off that hey, maybe I can handle this situation and show off in that situation. And this hasn't worked for me. You know, trying to do it that way has not worked for me. It tends to bring about diminishing returns, and you start doubting yourself, and you start thinking too much, and all of this stuff starts happening. It's better to just keep a low profile. Keep a low profile. This is what the advice. Longchenpa has this advice. He of course was the head of the Samye monastery, and had tremendous responsibilities and positions. And basically, he ultimately left all that and just went back and just spent the rest, you know, a lot of time in a cave. Most of his life in a cave. And he said, "Look, I'll tell you the truth. Is it's better to stay away from all that stuff. You'll be more successful." His final instructions before he left this world was to not only to us, but to future generations. He's one of the few teachers, well, let's put it this way, he's one of the teachers who I feel most addresses future generations. He made a point, he went out of his way to say that he wasn't just addressing those who were here with him, but he was absolutely addressing the generations to come into the future here. To listen to his advice and to call upon him. He also is one of the ones who most emphatically and clearly expressed that he wants us to call upon him, all those in the future generations, and he will respond. He made it ironclad clear that wherever you are, and wherever, whatever generation, however far you seem to be removed in time and space from what is where he was in Tibet or Bhutan, it makes no difference to him at all, that he absolutely welcomes you calling upon his help. Welcomes it, and he says, "I will respond." Amazing, 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 amazing. And he has, throughout the generations, throughout the centuries, he has responded many times, many places, in profoundly helpful ways. So he's made it crystal clear that he is someone who listens for your requests and prayers, hears them, and responds to them. Whoever you are, wherever you may be, doesn't matter. Very important to hear that. And this has been my experience. Without even having any idea who he was at all, he responded to a great prayer request I made for help for this world. And he showed up immediately, so fast. His responses means that he is absolutely focused on this. He does hear prayers. He does respond to them very rapidly, as I found. In fact, astonishingly, with astonishing rapidity. The very night after I made that prayer, he showed up in the dream, which he has done for many people, showed up in dreams, and give them great, great boosts and assist, spiritual assist, as he has done for me. And when I ask for confirmations now, they show up with amazing rapidity. I call it the 30-second thing. I say, "Okay, Longchenpa, I'm giving you 30 seconds because I know that's all you need." And usually it's less than 30 seconds. I mean, it's just like, wow. It's like he's just like totally focused on helping us. So a prayer request, boom. Boom. He responds immediately. Now, we're not used to this. It's shaking me up, actually. I'm getting used to this. It's leading to what? Telepathy. Now, the Tibetans communicate telepathically, a lot of the master. Oh, absolutely they do. And this is actually natural to us. This speech is very unnatural to us. It's egoic, actually. The way we communicate now is egoic. I call it the fascistic, feminist, patriarch, reptilian, sensory perception, egoic complex. Because that's really a good description of it. Okay, this bifurcation, the truth is that feminism and feminist and patriarchalness are two sides of one coin, and they are also part of the reptilian complex, which is really part of the sensory perception complex. And they're very paranoid and very fascistic. Okay, so the idea that we're supposed to choose between feminism and patriarchism is a completely false choice. They're two sides of the same coin. Two sides of the exact same coin, along with the reptilian, of this sensory perception egoic complex. And we don't want to have anything to do with that. And thank God, Longchamp and our Dharma Kings have a means to help us sidestep all of this. So, they're very telepathic, easily, and so are we, if we allow ourselves to be. But we've been conditioned not to. We've been intimidated and bullied into not be using our natural telepathic abilities. I don't know this for a fact. So we can recover these. We can actually recover these. As I accepted the position of an official in the court of the Dharma King Longchampa. He's given me the title of the official of Dharma Prince Clarity Ross, we can say. And so as an official in his court, I have an official position in his court now. I have a right to use telepathy. I absolutely have that right. And it's really how it's done, actually, how it's done. So that's why we don't need smartphones. We don't. That's junk technology. That's like colonialists coming over and offering the Indian glass beads from Venice and saying, here, in exchange, we get your land. Right, so this feminist, patriarchal, reptilian, sensory perception, ego complexes come into this world and offered us smartphones. And in return, we give them the planet. It's very, very same to the imperialists, the colonialists, imperial colonialism, coming over to the new world, conquistadors, etc. We give you this, you give us all your land. And the rights to use it in any way we want to. And the rights to put you on a reservation. It's just the same. It's actually the same. So they give us all this junk technology. This junk technology. And we're supposed to give them our planet. Well, we're not giving them our planet. Boo-hoo. Okay, boo-hoo. They can go cry tears if they want to, but they don't need to. You know, they need to realize that they're not the top authorities. The court of the Dharma, omniscient Dharma King Longchampa is way higher authority than any reptilian court or any feminist patriarchal court, any sensory perception agenda. Way higher authority. Totally trumps it. Completely trumps it. So this junk technology, we've gotten so addicted to it now. We think this is, you know, we have to communicate this way. Well, guess what? You know, it's all been being spied on. It can all be manipulated. It can all be blocked. All this kind of stuff, right? It can stop working. There's a lot of issues. EMP can affect it. So, not so with telepathy. Not so with telepathy. It's the go-to technology, actually. And you get it by just giving yourself permission. We are denying ourselves permission to use telepathy, actually. We're denying ourselves. All we have to do is just stop denying ourselves permission. And there it is. Same with other psychic abilities, too. And there's higher psychic abilities, but whatever. We're just denying ourselves this ability because sensory perception doesn't like it. You know, it's like, oh, the ego will never get to be born. We never can make a determinate self. You know, that's so unfair to the ego. Wait a minute. If there's no such thing as a determinate self ever, how can we be unfair to nothing? I mean, what is that? We're unfair to nothing? We've hurt the feelings of nothing. Nothing doesn't have any feelings. So how can they be hurt? How can... It's just a conceptual ruse, is it not? That we think there's some profundity to it. There's no profundity to it. But, you know, we're still stuck. There's still old habits, you know, keep echoing for a while. That's all. And the world is, you know, so wrapped up in officialdom and everything. Well, official this. I'm an official in the court of the omniscient Dharma King. Official that. I'm out here on official business, official that. We have our own means of communication. Official that. You don't tell us how to communicate. You don't have any authority in the court of the omniscient Dharma King Longchampa. You don't have any authority to tell the Dharma King how to run his court. I mean you. I'm talking, of course, to those who would try to say, you can't use telepathy. You can't do this. You can't do this. This is where you have to go. We have the right to confined your activities. No, you have no right to confine our activities. In fact, we may have some right to confine your activities temporarily, right? This is what we would say. Because you're messing around with delay too much here. Yeah, it's not good for you. It's not in your own best interest to mess around with delay that much. It's not in anyone's best interest for what's going on in the world right now, actually. So the court of Longchenpa may step in and do a little tweaking here and there, right? Absolutely. That can certainly happen. It probably will happen. So I have a new life, officialdom. Keep in mind that the rebirth that Jesus Christ talks about is choosing a new form of perception, clear light vision of intrinsic clarity. So we're deciding we've already done this, as if we've already done this. So that exercise we did, as if we're sitting in a pool, as if we've already accepted this new perception. This is the practice we do, and since we did it with such determination and clarity and commitment, it's a done deal. As far as longevity is concerned, it's a done deal. It's a done deal. So I feel that way. It's a done deal. So I accept the position, official position, and I get to be assigned to, you know, whatever official business he wants to be carried out here to help us out. And this is something that people, some people can relate to. Not everybody, understandably so. I tend to be very abstract, so I don't. But it's like a new life, a new job, which is very cool, very nice. To have a new job, I've had enough of the old stuff. I never thought I'd ever be an official. I mean, if you ask me, that's the last thing I'd ever thought possible. It could never happen. Actually, an official in some sort of, you know, government or some sort of court of a king. An official? What? Yeah. It's like, wow. I was offered the position like 5 years ago, and I just said, wow, I don't know. You know, it's like, let me think about that. It's very difficult to wrap my head around being an official. I'm very unofficial, you know. Which makes a very good official, actually, in the court of the Dharma King. And he's not looking for anyone who lusts after being an official. He's looking after those who, you know, who can absolutely, you know, have no interest whatsoever in being an official. So we won't become overly officious, of course. Not to say that you know, I couldn't do it. I believe I can do it. There's nothing wrong with good, really good officials. They can be helpful. They can be very, very helpful. Because, again, we're not quite ready to set down our honoring of time and the belief that we can create a determinate structure, which we can't. So we're just honoring our wish that we can, even though we can't. You can do that, right? If you fail to do something, you can always fantasize, like, well, what would it have been like if I could do it? And we're just fantasizing. What would it have been like if we were actually able to create determinacy? And so we fantasize this universe, this world, bodies, plants, vegetation, everything, so-called sensory perception structure. We think we're so. This is just a dream. It's just Jesus says, just a dream, honoring our idle wish for lack of freedom, for determinacy. That's all it is. And so, you know, we gradually wind down our attachment to this dream. And as we do that, there's all sorts of adjustments we make. And we're not quite ready to completely dispense with any governments whatsoever, any officialness. And, you know, we're not quite ready for that. Okay, that's fine. So what we do is we use that for us to help us keep minimizing delay and spend time in the right way. Skillful means right practice, full stop in the wow. But at least we have some structure here. We have an omniscient Dharma King, and then that omniscient Dharma King's court, and in that court are officials, courtiers and officials, and there's various positions in the court. And so this has been the tradition throughout history. And the fact is that most, hear this very carefully now, as Jesus says, hear this. Very important. We have flirted with freedom, but we're scared of it. We have to realize this. Just accept it. Be humble and repentant. Our real problem is continuity fear, meaning we're afraid of freedom. We're afraid of freedom. So we have to understand this is the only problem we have, but it's a very, very severe problem. And once you accept this, then you'll accept the necessary remedies. You won't try to be showing off like, oh, look how free I am, I'm so free. Because the backlash, you'll have a backlash to that. It's better to go in a more moderate, safer way. To just recognize, I got a really severe fear of absolute indeterminacy. It's like an abyss, as Longchenpa says. Our fear is thinking that freedom is an abyss. Well, of course we think it's an abyss because we believe that determinacy is reality. And that God wants us to try to create determinacy out of indeterminacy, and that's our role, that God created us. We believe that this is what we tell ourselves, we just made this up, that God created us to establish, to change reality into a reality of determinacy. So this is what we're working on. This is why the world's here, body's here. And we think that God made bodies, made worlds, so we could work on changing spirit into reality, into determinacy. This is completely made up, absolutely fabricated by our mind, just whimsically making this up. No truth to it whatsoever. God did not create spirit to change reality into determinacy. But we have been believing this for so long and working on it that the idea of going back to absolute freedom, which is completely indeterminate, there's no definition at all of reality. Anything can be everything. And it already is, actually. It just depends what we want to emphasize for our experiencing. That, you know, it scares us, like, wow. I don't know. I can't handle this. You know? So there's some structure as we go back to this. We accept some structure which implies some sort of determinancy, temporary. Jesus says, of course, it's pragmatically, it'll seem to be some temporary structure still there. We can go to a reduced intensity realm, a Pure Land realm, where it still seems like a world. It still seems like structures and stuff. But we realize it's very plastic and plasticity and flexible. And like, I can have this look something like different. It can the stone can now appear like a diamond or something. It's like, wow. And then we can leave it like a diamond. Then we can change it back. And everything is very responsive to our play with it. Very responsive, and we get used to that. And so this is how we work. We work our way back towards actual reality and dropping our fantasy of determinacy. So the truth is, in this world, is we flirted with freedom. We flirted, and what happened? Terrible backlash. A lot of the problem we have now in the world is due to the baby boomers, the 60s, 70s, 80s, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, where we tried to break free of determinancy and hang loose, you know, get loose. And that caused a massive backlash. And now the very ones who are all hippied out are the ones now trying to control freaks, trying to control everybody and tell everybody how the structure they have to live under. It's amazing. Because the backlash, you can't take the spiritual path through the use of stimulants and drugs and free love, free love, rock and roll, all this, you know, let's just get crazy, break down all our mental structures and all this kind of stuff. That brings about a terrible backlash that sneaks up on us, and we don't even realize. I don't even think the hippies, the baby boomers, I don't even think they realize what they're doing. They're under the guidance of fear. And their arrogance won't allow them to see it. They feel they know the answer for everybody. Very dangerous situation. So they didn't take the spiritual path in the right way. And this is what a lot of the spiritual depths told us. The Tibetans shook their head and says, you guys are bringing a lot of trouble down the road here. That's not how you do it. You have to be very sober. Christianity has always emphasized, the virtues of sobriety. So we basically just took a daredevil path and then paid the severe price of the backlash. So now, really, we're all actually desperate for control. We want to be controlled because we got so freaked out by indeterminacy. We want to avoid it at all costs. And how do you do that? You invite the reptilians in. So what happened was this daredevil approach of the baby boomers and those their children, etc., the sex, drugs, rock and roll trip that they went on, it freaked them out, and they started calling in the reptilians. And the reptilians said, oh, gee, someone is calling for us to help them. Why don't we go help them out? They want control. Well, we're good at control. Yeah. Especially a lot of the women got freaked out because, you know, women like structure in terms of because they're having children. They want some sense of a structured future, so they feel confident in having children. So they get more freaked out more quickly. They say, hey, wait a minute. The 60s, 70s, 80s, sex, drugs, rock and roll thing, the women got very concerned about it. And they said, you know, how am I going to have children? How can I feel confident having children? A lot of them, that's how abortion came on the scene. Women didn't feel confident in having children anymore because of the destructuredness of the situation. And so they got very angry about that. And so that's what feminism arose, the virulent form of it arose from that. They got freaked out, very scared, and they called in the reptilians is what they really did. A lot of them had they made psychic connections with the reptilians. They absolutely did. They have the right to do that. I mean, they have the capacity and the right. I mean, this is what they wanted to do. So they invited them into this world and said, hey, we'll support you here. We'll run interference for you. Because we want structure. Okay, because we want, you know, we're used to this world being very structured. Some despotic or aristocratic system that tells you this is your future, this governance tells you this. And, you know, you get a husband, their job is to go work, slave for their whole lives and provide food, house, car, all the payments for insurance, everything. And then the women say, okay, I feel confident I'm gonna start popping out kids because I feel confident the kids will have, you know, a good life. So I'll get busy doing that. But so many looked at the world and said, well, wait a minute. I don't have any confidence at all that my kids will have a great life here. So I don't feel I can have children. So this says, we don't like this because we're used to having children. We think that's our purpose in life. Well, it really isn't. That's the purpose of dream bodies. These are all dream bodies, and the purpose we're giving them is to produce determinacy, out of change reality to a determinate reality. So by having all these children, we're trying to do just that, change reality to a determinate reality. What we really are is spirit. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So the backlash came in the form of virulent feminism, called feminism. Very, very severe backlash. They called in the reptilians. And funnily enough, you know, how they got, what they did was they said, hey, the patriarchy has let us down. So we're going to bring in a real heavyweight patriarchy, which are the reptilians. The reptilians are these nasty patriarchal control freaks. Where even the women are patriarchal control freaks, but you might call them feminists too, which is really just the same thing. Okay, these patriarchal control freaks and feminist control freaks, it's the same. It's a desire for determinateness that stretches into the future. Of course, determinism has to be where? In the future. In the now, there is no determinism at all. So you have to believe in a future where there's processes taking place, and you can prove that there's a determinate structure that you're following. You know, you can't work on changing reality unless you act as though you're following a roadmap, a path of determinate structure that is progressing. You have to dream in that way. So the reptilians have been dreaming this way in a long time. So the feminists called in the reptilian, says, look, we need Big Daddy to come in here and crack down and make sure that we never go through this again. It freaked them out. Of course, they wanted to go on that trip to see what it was like. And I think a lot of men realized that they may freak out, and they realized they did freak out. They couldn't take it. And so this is what's happened. The idea of not having children, they realized the biological clock started ticking. It was easy to say that when they're 16. These teeny boppers and the young hippie chicks and stuff, they're 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. As they start, the biological clock started ticking, and some start getting, you know, their 20s, late 20s, 30s. Oh my gosh. They suddenly said, hey, you know, I've been ripped off. I'm about ready to lose my life, my legacy, you know, everything. Says, no way, you know, no way. You terrible, you know, sexist pigs, you know, you led me down this terrible path and all this kind of stuff. They got very, very angry. And so this is virulent feminism rose out of this, which is now, along with the the patriarchal reptilians and this sensory perception ego complex is running the world. Running the world. They invite them in, and they're turning over the world to them, actually. They said, you guys, you're in charge now and fix the world. We want it fixed. And we want to make sure, you know, we got this very heavy determinant structure. So we can now relax and feel comfortable that it will be taken care of. We have children, they'll all be taken care of. The mother will be taken care of. The children, the grandchildren will all be taken care of in this beautiful materialistic paradise. And we can continue to keep trying to do what we think God wants us to do, which is change reality into a determinant structure. Of course, God has absolutely no such mandate or plans for us whatsoever. And so we're still attracted to reality as it is, the now as it is. You can't leave the now because there's no definition of the now. There's nothing to leave. It's all completely indeterminate. So that we're always attracted back to that. And so we have to keep fighting against that more determinate structure. Oh, and we keep saying, what is that threat that we keep feeling? We've got to get rid of it. Let's legislate against it. So we really chickened out towards freedom. We have to accept this. This is part of repentance, as we chickened out. Now, I'm one of those who kept with it. It was very difficult. But obviously, I didn't chicken out to the extent that most have. I certainly chickened out to some extent, and I had to face all of that. But I kept saying, no. I'm going to succeed. I'm going to take the offer of pure land and what's available to me to help me with this structure problem, this continuity fear. I know that there's Holy Spirit has a plan to help us with continuity fear. So I said, no, I'm going to take that way. That's the right way, and I'm just going to stick with it. So that's what I've done. I've just stuck with it through thick and thin, and. Of course, you know, the males are persona non grata to the feminists, which is really the de facto ideology ruling the world right now, which is, again, it's really feminist, patriarchal, reptilian, patriarchal, sensory perception, ego complex is ruling the roost in this world right now. And so someone such as myself, you know, has been persona non grata for a long time, because, you know, represent, you know, those terrible guys that take us towards indeterminacy. Well, I'm not taking any way one towards indeterminacy through sex, drugs, and rock and roll. I'm going the safe way through dedicated, full stop, in the wow spiritual practice. That's the right way to do it. And so the Tibetans have acknowledged that. Longchamp has acknowledged that, said you're doing it the right way. So he's, you know, kudos, giving me kudos and homage to doing it the right way. And this doesn't have to freak anyone out, actually. It doesn't have to freak the women out. Theoretically, they can actually even still have children. Right? And when you practice in this way, you could still function in a practical, pragmatic way. But you have faith in that you can get free of the continuity fear, and so can your children. And so that's a real great destiny for your children. Or you might choose not to. You say, why should I keep trying to push the agenda of determinacy forward? I don't really feel like I need to do that. But historically, of course, because women are ones that have the children, they are much more focused on a determinate structure and demand that the men, you know, keep their focus on that too. And if you don't, you know, out to a monastery to you, you know, get out of our society. We want a determinate structure. So women lag behind a little bit in terms of the continuity fear, working on it. That's the tendency, because they've had a more habit of being committed to determinacy, because, wow, you know, having a child is a massive, massive commitment, and you want that child to further, you know, to be an extension of what you are. The woman wants the children to be an extension of what they are, which is this a desire for determinacy. So it's not easy for women to get free of that. They have to work at it to a tremendous extent, but they can. They absolutely can. But the temptation towards feminism is extreme, because the feminists offer us, you know, they say, let's bust heads. We'll get this determinate structure better than it's ever been, which is what we're headed towards right now. Do we really have a choice in the United States in this election? No, it's like determinancy and determinacy. I'll get this determinacy structure figured out. No, I'll get this determinacy structure figured out. You got the matriarchy and the patriarchy, the feminism and the patriarchy, saying, no, we know the best way to advance determinancy. What kind of choice is that, actually? It's no choice at all. So, you know, you're basically saying, well, how do I err on the side of caution? Which way do I, you know, err on the side of caution here? It's a tricky situation, isn't it? But I can tell you this, I would not advise anyone to get into bed with the reptilians, as the feminists have done. Okay, I would not advise anyone to do that. That's not a good choice at all. That's a regretful choice, okay. So, if you're going to choose between the lesser of two ills, you go with the patriarchal side of things. You absolutely do. It's basically saying no to the reptilians. Say no, we've got it covered here. You stay out, butt out. And so it's the lesser of two evils, basically. I'm phrasing it this way because this is how I see it. We have a situation in the United States and globally where we have to choose between the lesser of two evils. Do we go with the feminist reptilian patriarchy, or we go with the traditional patriarchy? In terms of determinant structure, and so, without saying that either one is good, they're both terrible. I would say if you're not yet committed to the court of a Dharma King, then you go with the patriarchal, traditional patriarchal structure. We know how to work with that better, how to get past it better. Males are less committed to determinism because they don't have the attachment to the children as an extension of their own body so much as women do. This is not a put down of women at all. It's just a fact, isn't it? It's a biological fact that the female body is a very strong attachment to the children, as if it were an extension of their own body, their own psyche, that kind of thing. And it's hard to just believe in indeterminism, complete indeterminism. You feel like you're abandoning your children. That kind of feeling, you know, but it's not true at all. You're actually gracing them with the same option, saying, look, mom can do this. You're not really an extension of me at all. Bodies are not even real at all. You're not even a body, you're spirit. And so I see you as spirit, not as body at all. And I didn't give birth to your spirit at all. God did. So all I did was just give you a form, a communication device form to communicate through, but you're not an extension of my body or my psyche or anything like that. You're an extension of the oneness. Okay, so a woman can speak to their children, the mother can speak to their children like that, and some do. But it's not easy for the majority of them. The majority of them want a very strong determinant structure, and they see the reptilians are giving a stronger determinant structure than the traditional male patriarchy, which is true. The reptilians will give a stronger determinant structure, but guess what? It'll be too strong, and you'll regret it. You'll have buyer's regrets. So Longchenpa's stepping in here, and he'll do what he needs to do. I don't know what he's going to do. I'm just a lowly official, and so, you know, it just whatever I need to know, I know, and there's plenty that I may not need to know, so I don't know it, and that's fine. But he'll certainly do something. You can count on that. He's all business. Yeah, my take on him is very sober, very focused. He's a man of business. He's here on business. As he appeared in the dream to me, he's here on business. He knows his business, and that's what he's about. And he will accomplish his business, whatever it is. He will accomplish it. Now, if we back off desire for determinancy, automatically we back off feminism and reptilian patriarchy. We automatically back off of that and say, whoa, I don't want that. So to some extent, the candidacy in the United States, the Trump candidacy, represents people backing off the feminism, reptilian patriarchy. Feminist, reptilian patriarchy. That's, they're trying to foist upon us here. They're backing off that and say, no. No, we'll go back to the traditional patriarchy. That's fine. And a lot of women feel this way too, because they see too, it's too much. It's bad. It's really too much. It's getting in the way of my salvation. So Trev might just be someone who's helping us say, you know, it's okay to back off that. It's okay. I'm backing off of it, and it's okay for you to back off of it too. And I'm telling you for sure, as an official in the court of the Omniscient Dharma King Long Champ, I'm saying it's okay for you to back off of this. It's okay for you to back off of this. In your spirit. Now, we don't want to be stuck with a determinate male patriarchy either, do we? Ultimately, no, we don't. But actually, it's much more flexible. I mean, the feminists, they love talking about how flexible you are, all these feminine qualities. No, that's superficial. Inside, they're very, very inflexible. They say, no, we have to have determinacy, or else my life is meaningless. They're very inflexible about the core issue. Extremely inflexible about it. Whereas men on the surface may seem less flexible, but when it gets to the core issue, there tends to be more flexibility about it. It says, well, yeah, I could see it both ways. I'm not really committed. I mean, men tend to be less committed to the children, right, in terms of trying, you know, determinate in a determinate way. Of course they are. They don't see the children as an extension of their own body nearly as much. And so it's easier for them to just say, oh, maybe we're not bodies at all. I might be okay with that. That's the core issue. Is identity, what's our identity? Is it determinate or indeterminate? It can't be both, actually. Cannot be both. Either it's perfectly indeterminate or it's not perfectly indeterminate, which means it's determinate. And it's one or the other. It's black and white. I'm wearing my black and white linen shirt. You can't see it, but I'm wearing it today. My trunks are black and white. Black and white. It's black. This is my motif. It's black and white. Either reality is flawlessly, perfectly indeterminate, or it's not flawlessly and perfectly indeterminate. Okay? There's no wiggle room there at all. None. Zero. It can't possibly be both, can it? Now, the feminist reptilian patriarchs coalition is offering us the moon to go along with them. Absolutely. So there's a lot of men that have gone along with it because they've been promised. Oh, what haven't they been promised, actually? I was promised the moon. Absolutely. Oh, we'll take care of you. You know, you just... paradise. You'll just have all the luxury, everything you want. Luxury. Sybaritic. Hedonistic, luxurious lifestyle, paradise, all this stuff that was offered to me. That's the devil's temptation. And I said, wow, that'd be kind of cool. Who wouldn't think like, interesting. You mean everyone will treat me nicely and respect? Oh yeah, of course. You'll be a high official in our structure if you just work on determinism for us. Well, very high, as a matter of fact, they promised me. Of course, they're going to give any inducement or promise to someone who's leading towards a court of a Dharma King. They're going to try to prevent that at all costs. So they say, what's your position going to be? Well, I'm going to be a lowly official. We're going to offer you a way higher position. I mean, you're going to be one of the highest positions in our determinant feminist reptilian patriarchy. One of the highest positions. So many perks, unbelievable respect. You'll be attached to a very, very powerful official here. Extremely high official. You'll be helping them. Yeah, one of the highest. Or maybe the highest. You'll be attached to the highest, they promised me, you know. It's just on and on. Wow, did they promise the moon? So, of course they'll promise you the moon. What else can they do? Of course they won't. They don't have any plans whatsoever to fulfill any of those promises. Just empty promises. They'll get rid of you as fast as they can. They'll say, this one has a temptation to go to the Dharma King court, and so we got to bury him as deep as we possibly can bury him. They're just trying to prevent me from going to the court of the Dharma King. They'll make any promise to prevent you, then once you, if you decide not to, then they'll feed you to the fishes. This is true. It's very true. I've lived through it. Oh, you can serve this goddess, this feminist reptilian goddess who's serving the god of the patriarchal god or something, or the ultimate goddess or whatever they want to structure it. They can structure it various ways. You'll be like super important. Oh my gosh. People will listen to what you have to say. Well, of course, if you're teaching determinism, most of the world will listen to what you have to say. And so theoretically, you could be in this very powerful position. Everybody listens and does what you say. Comrade, hike in the Politburo, whatever. But, you're just selling your soul to the devil in doing so, and teaching people delay is all you would be doing. Right? Isn't this right? Having lived through it, I can say it is right. Absolutely, it's right on the money, spot on. So I'll accept the lowest position, whatever Longchenpa wants for me. He says Dharma Prince. Well, maybe that's, I don't know. Is that a responsible position or how responsible? I don't know. I'll accept whatever he wants and just do what he has, help him out. Because I know he is helping us all towards accepting the indeterminate perception, the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. He is all about that, helping us, everyone, to that, which is the right step towards healing our continuity fear and ultimately accepting that our identity is that of perfect indeterminacy, in other words, perfect freedom. That we, in every moment, there's only the now. There's no now to leave, so to speak, in terms of definition. Now is just a term referring to this absolute freedom, perfect indeterminacy, that nothing ever determines what I am. Okay? There's only more and more and more glorious experiencing. And we can't really describe it, but we just have to have faith that this is so. So, the very morning after I met Longchenpa in the dream, I had this experience of indeterminate identity, of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. I have this experience, and I just say, wow, okay, this is what the goal is. I see it. Oh, it's very simple. It's very easy. Amazingly easy. Why aren't we doing this? It's like no difficulty to it at all, as a matter of fact. It's like natural. There's a natural vision. Oh, okay. And so this is what I realized. This is what Longchenpa, the one I met in the dream, this is what they're about. I didn't know who it was, but I said, wow, I like that. That's his calling card. So I know, I said, this is what we all want. This is what we're all going towards. And in fact, sensory perception is doomed to extinction, completely doomed to extinction. It was doomed to extinction from the very beginning. It was never born at all, actually. It's just a dream of what if it could have been born. It's never been born. Determinism has never been born in any way whatsoever. Keep this in mind. There's never been an iota of determinism ever take place. Never. This is simply a dream honoring our wish that there be determinism, but it's never actually happened. Nice little cool breeze now. That's nice. That's part of the enjoyment of a hot day, right? Is you ever even little and even a little cool breeze, you're very in gratitude towards it. Say, ah, I love this. Thank you. It's wonderful. So it sort of tunes us into gratitude, does it not? Experiencing a hot day, and then we have a cool drink, a cool breeze, and we say, ah, I love that relief. That's very nice. Thank you very much. Some shade, sitting, oh, wonderful. And we tend to be in a more grateful. I talked to someone from the South recently. I said, that name, she had a name. I said, ah, you must be from the South, that name. She goes, I am. And I said, I'm from Alabama. I lived up in Alabama, I lived in Florida for a while. And I loved Florida. She says, oh, God, I loved it. And I said, well, I really love the South. I've never been there, but the people, she goes, we're more hospitable. And I said, yeah, you certainly are. And she goes, yeah. And then she said, we think of ourselves, well, she goes, actually, we're more refined, can't you tell? And I said, oh, yeah, of course. And I said, well, yeah, also, but you don't take yourselves too seriously. But they do think of themselves as more refined. Because sugar, I like to just sit here and fan myself on the patio and drink a mint julep. And just feel gratitude for what I got, love being from South Carolina, honey, sugar. bless your heart. When you're the hot muggy, you're grateful for just a little bit of relief. You know, it's right. Yeah, temper class people go. I mean, anyone ever express gratitude here in the Silicon Valley? I don't know. It's like, what is this? Like, how are you today? You know, hey, how's it going? Ah, going great. How you doing? Ah, you know, I just feel so grateful for everything I got today. You know, I just so happy, grateful for the car, for the air conditioning that I have, and just love the Lord so much for what He's done for me. Where's the time just to, like, you know, feel gratitude? It's very important. It doesn't exist here, really. Yeah, so y'all need some shade? Come on over here. Have a soda pop. Have a sit down. I'll get you by a soda pop. Sit down here for a while. Give it a fan. Get cooled down. Wait, no, 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 no. Nobody's in any hurry to go anywhere right now. Take it easy for a while, huh? Yeah, hospitality here, man. We're all friends here. Meaning, we all suffering from the heat down here. And so, you know, we understand. Take it easy, man. Take it easy. Take it easy, brother. Ain't nothing we got to do, really. Y'all just take it easy. Yeah. So when you're in the extreme heat, everybody's got this feeling of, like, being kind to one another. Here, can I get you some shade? Can I get you a drink? Can I help you with the... I know what it's like. I'm experiencing it too. We're all suffering together. So we're kind of in tune with our suffering, which is really good. It's really good. It's very helpful. Longchenpa's teacher, what, Kumarajza or something like that, he came to a camp. There's like a whole, like 100 devotees or around him. They're all in this camp in some valley. It's freezing. It was like so inhospitable in terms of the temperature and the environs and everything. They lived in little tents. His teacher had a little tiny tent that he was only able to, big enough where he could sit up in the tent. Longchenpa had a burlap sack. That's all he had. That's the only possessions he had. So he had to sleep out in the freezing cold snowstorms in a little burlap sack, eating berries, gathering berries for his food, and constantly moving around. It was just brutal. Yet they all were in it together, you see. They were all in this brutal conditions, and this certainly forged an enormous kindness and generosity and feeling of virtue to everyone. Like, we're all suffering so bad here together. Any little thing we can do to help one another is so, so welcome. Yeah, it's a very powerful technique that they use there. Or you got to be very confident to handle that situation. That is for sure. Longchenpa was so poor, he couldn't pay the guru fee. I mean, back then you paid a fee for the guru to support the sangha, right? Because they were all, you know, had nothing to do with money anymore, supposedly. But actually, some of them did own something, but you had to pay a fee to help the whole situation expand and go forward in the transmission and everything. So, he didn't have anything. He had nothing. He was like a hippie in the 60s. I'm just hitchhiking around the world. I got nothing. I got nothing but the clothes on my back. Maybe a sleeping bag, a little old thread-worn cotton sleeping bag. That's it. And a lot of the hippies emulated these, you know, Dharma bums, you know. They call themselves, Jack Kerouac calls them Dharma bum, the Dharma bum thing. Wrote about the Dharma bums. And so his teacher paid his fee for him because he knew that this was the one that was going to spread the Dharma like nobody's business, before or after. He paid the fee himself, but the conditions were brutal. You know, you'd die of hypothermia, frostbite. It's just, I guess you had to keep a fire going. You had to know how to conserve your energy, and probably you had to learn how to generate tumo or heat. I imagine that's how he survived. That's one of the trainings they use, is how to generate inner heat. There's some way to do it. I don't know how, but they figured it out. Yeah. So this idea of suffering together to practice the kindness and virtues is actually a powerful way. And intense heat is very helpful for that. You see somebody, oh, you know, hey, get out of the heat. Come over here. have a cold drink, have some electrolytes here, you know, wear a hat, you know, get a shade, let me, oh, you don't have some here, I got something for it. It's like that. You take care of one another. You make sure that you don't fry from the heat. Here's a nice cool spot here, or here's a nice beautiful spot. Take it easy. Nah, I'm too busy trying to produce determinate structure. Nah, you gotta kill yourself in the heat. Come on over here. Wow, that's really beautiful. Look at this lake and the palm trees. It's just so beautiful. Why do you just hang out here? Some food here. Oh, okay. Yeah. I'll have some food. I'll have a drink. And after a while, they kind of get relaxed. They say, wow, I don't need to be chasing after determinate structure in this heat, you know. So it's a great excuse, isn't it? It's a great excuse. Ah, it's too hot to work on determinate structure right now. So I hope Longchamp, I'm sure he understands this, can use this to our advantage. That's too doggone hot. Let's just sit in the pool right now. I'm not gonna try to go make my next $1 million right now. So it's very, very important that we not keep pursuing determinate structure right now in this long, hot summer of 2016. Vitally important. Crucial, because if we keep buying into this determinate structure, guess what? We're going to get the feminist reptilian fascistic head-busting structure. That's why they got all those FEMA camps, right? The reptilians said, look, we'll clean things up for you, don't worry. Just get all these camps ready. And the cattle cars and all this stuff, it's all there. The people who are aware of this, they're not nutcases. I mean, some of them on, you know, YouTube, they'll say, you know, whatever. There's a bunch of kids on there here that... Some of them, and some older, but there's some responsible people too that they, you know, hey, they've got these camps ready. They certainly do. And the reptilians will clean the house. They'll say, okay, you brought us in to bring about a super heavy determinist structure, and this is what we're doing. And the feminists will just sit back and let them do it. They say, go get them, boys. Cheering them on. My heroes, those are my heroes. Pretty similar. Even worse than Nazi Germany, where the Fraulein's were cheering on the brown shirts, the thugs, and the Nazis, the SS stormtroopers, cheering them on. Go get them, boys. We want determined structure. These doggone commies have ruined our country and brought anarchy to the country. So we want a heavy determinant structure, and you go get them, boys. Oh, the Fraulein's were, you're my hero. You're our heroes, heroes of the fatherland. We love you so much in every which way. This is what happened, and this is what will happen. Coming going forward, there's a high possibility of this happening here. And they'll cheer them on. You go stick those son of a guns in a prison camp and we'll rehabilitate the heck out of them. Oh, gee, they couldn't survive real rehabilitation. Well, that's their fault. They must have been resistant to it. That's too bad. But we're not going to put up with any of this nonsense of these boys anymore. We want a heavy determinant structure here. So we can have children in peace and prosperity and think that, boy, we're going to be taken care of and our children are going to be taken care of and no more of this indeterminate nonsense here. It's too scary. We want to get rid of it forever. So they got their thugs lined up. Count on it. Reptilians got their thugs all lined up, all tattooed, all lathered up, tattooed up, ready to go. And the feminists won't lift a finger to stop them. And we've already realized this was coming, right? I mean, this present... determinist structure right now, we have governance of the United States, they're not lifting a finger to stop these trends. In fact, they're encouraging them, because they're really being run by the feminist reptilian patriarchal structure. This present governance structure is being controlled by them behind the scenes. Absolutely it is. That's why the police force, which was used to protecting the old patriarchal structure, is being undermine and they're trying to destroy their morale. And I know people who know police, and they're saying, hey, oh, this crime just happened. Really? Well, I'm here in a restaurant having my lunch. I got right to finish my lunch here. They're not rushing out. They go rush out and they ask, they don't even see what happened. Nobody says anything. No, I didn't see what happened. Oh, okay, I'll go back to my lunch. I mean, the heck with it. So basically, the idea of keeping the law and order of a patriarchal, traditional conservative patriarchal structure, the police are no longer, they've been told to stand down on that. This is what's happened. And this has been done intentionally by this, whatever you want to call it, this governance structure in place right now, for instance, in the United States, but it's a sort of a global idea in many places. It's really a feminist, reptilian, patriarchal governance structure that's been in charge of the United States for the last 8 years. It most certainly has. That's what's been here. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. Now they want to get in their real hot cookie in there. She'll just step back and say, go get them, boys. And cheer them on. This is a fact. And people know this. Why do you think so many people in the United States are so jittery right now? Because they realize that's what will happen if this comes to pass. I mean, she won't lift a finger to help it, stop it. She said, well, that's what you had coming. So, boo-hoo. So, you might want to consider getting into a court of the Dharma, one of the Dharma Kings. And I never liked, the patriarchal structure either, of course. It's way too determinant-based. Way too determinant-based. It's the lesser of the two evils at this point, for sure. But we can do better than that. We can get into a court of a Dharma King, right? So we have a third option here. We have a third option. Take this third option. Take the third option here. Get into a court of a Dharma King as a courtier. You don't have to be an official. I was offered a position, an official position, but I don't believe you have to be offered. I don't believe you have to be offered a official position. You can audit it. You can be a courtier. You can decide this is the kind of structure you want right now, which leads you to ultimately the means to overcome your continuity fear. Basically, it's a practice structure which helps you overcome your continuity fear. What is better than that? Nothing. It's the best. It's the best option. It's the best option. So, I gave kudos to Trump when it was deserved because he said, let's back away from this feminist, reptilian, patriarchy, fascist control structure. Determinant control structure. Let's back away from that. We don't need to choose that. He says we can have the old patriarchal system. And so at least we start this momentum of backing away from the edge of the cliff. Okay, that's good. But what I did is I kept backing away. And I said, okay, but let's also back away from the traditional male patriarchal structure too, which beneath the surfaces was actually run by queen bees. But let's back away from that too. And let's go into the court of the Dharma Kings. Because they will then see to it that the determinant structure we have is designed to encourage and support right spiritual practice, which ultimately evaporates our continuity fear, which ultimately enables us to dwell in the pure lands, death-free realms, and from there to drop all belief in any necessity of determinism whatsoever and abide in the perfect indeterminate now, which is reality. So that is by far and away the best choice. The other two are the lesser of two evils. This choice is a fabulous, great choice. Super positive choice. So this is what I have been advocating, and in fact I've advocated this throughout all my videos, is I've advocated to those who are backing away from the fascistic, feminist, reptilian, patriarchal structure. And many have been backing away from this. And so I advocated to them. I said, look, don't get caught up, though, in going back to the old male patriarchal conservative structure. That's the lesser of two evils, yes, but there's a better option. So I've always been consistent with this. I said, there's a better option. And I wish that more had listened to this. And maybe I hope they do now. It's a way better option. But still, they're into their survivalism. They're going right back to the traditional male patriarchal thing, queen bee male patriarchal thing about, we've got our system of determinism and that works great. And let's just keep doing this, and they're going back to that. I say, look, why we were miserable too under that, right? It's not like we've had happy days here actually. But it's certainly true that under that system we were able to devise. Means to some, we got some wiggle room. We were able to get some wiggle room. Whereas with the reptilians in charge, boy, you're not going to get wiggle room. Okay. With the feminist reptilians and reptilian patriarchs in charge, you're not, there's no wiggle room. They're going to monitor, you know, your every breath. They already are starting to do that. It's amazing how much monitoring is getting into everything. Hey, it's so easy to monitor your car. I realize today, it's a surprise they haven't done it yet. They can just put a monitor on your car, which tells exactly where you were and exactly what speed you're traveling. It completely gives a data record of your speed every second. Easy to do. Very easy to do, is it not? With the digital system, digitally they can already get their speed. Just in GPS, they know exactly where you are. So they know you're traveling exactly this fast in exactly this place. And so your driving speed will be completely monitored. Of course, they're going to automatic cars, which will monitor, you know, keep your speed automatically for you. Well, guess what? Sometimes we like to go slow, and sometimes we like to go fast. Guess what? The male patriarchy all allowed a certain amount of freedom in terms of our laws. Didn't want to make too many laws. Didn't want to, so, you know, if somebody wants to go be in Montana and go, you know, 95 or 100 miles an hour on an open stretch, you know what? Good for them. We're not going to worry about it. You know, we give ourselves some autonomy, some amount of freedom. And if I want to go slow, I can go slow. I don't need the government monitoring my every action. I'm self-governing. The whole idea of the United States was to be more self-governing. This was the experiment. This is the plan of very responsible people who are willing to be self-governing. Were supposed to come to this country, and they did. Problem with this unrestricted immigration is you get a lot of people coming to this country who they just you know they're fleeing, you know, oppression, but they're not necessarily self-governing or into being self-governing at all. They actually would like a heavy control system over their lives. They just want a nice one that keeps things more stable. So, but in order for the United States to work, it had to be people who are willing to be self-governing and were brought up that way. I'm certainly very self-governing. I don't need laws, actually. You have an innate sense of what is right and what is fair. You don't even need any laws. I don't need lawyers. I don't need courts. I don't need laws. I don't need any of that stuff. You might say, you know, people say this libertarianism. I feel like I can get along with my neighbors just fine, and we can all get along just fine. Common sense, golden rule, we have these virtues and principles, repentant mind. I can get along with anyone who has a repentant mind. We don't need all these laws and governance. This is the ideal of the United States, and of course this ideal is gone down the toilet as you just allow unrestricted immigration to take place. You should be able to pick the finest in the world. If this experiment to work, you should be able to say, it's like Harvard or Stanford. How do you think Stanford would be if you just allowed anyone who wanted to go to Stanford to get in and just flood the campus with a bunch of illiterate people? Is that it, how do you think Stanford would allow for that? And yet there's these liberal think tanks that this is what should allow, you know, all this immigration. Really? They would allow that at Stanford. Okay, let's see Stanford allow unrestricted enrollment from anyone. That you don't need any resume at all. So when they start doing that, then they can start talking to me straight, you know, without being hypocrites. Okay, and then we'll have a talk. So I'm, you know, waiting on that, but I'm not going to hold my breath for that. Same with Harvard, all these liberal think tanks. Let's see their unrestricted enrollment take place. And see how they like that, and see how well their institution functions, and how smoothly it functions then. Yeah, and yet they think it's good for this country, for this to be happening. No, it's not. It's empowering the reptilian, the feminist reptilian patriarchal coalition. It's empowering that. Because they're scared. They say, oh, if, you know, if Trump gets elected, you'll have so much freedom. You know what the heck to do with it. Everyone goes, oh, no, that's too much. We don't want that. You know, we don't know how to handle it. Oh, yeah, okay. We need, come on, we need you to tell us what to do. Come on. I don't need anyone to tell me what to do, actually. I'll listen to Longchampa because I know he has my best interest at heart. So if he tells me what to do, I'll say thank you and I'll do it. Because I know he has reached pure indeterminacy himself, and he's blissfully satisfied with it, and he knows the ways and means for anyone to get there, and his purpose is to get us there, So that's my purpose too. So we share the same purpose. So I'm happy to accept whatever kind of governance he has. And I'll accept some governance. I have no problem with that at all. I respect the law. I understand, you know, speed limits and all this kind of stuff, and it's fine. I got no problem with. I've always respected the law. I've tried to. May not agree with it, but I understand there's a purpose for it for a while. So, but I don't need much. I don't need much of myself. I can govern myself. I feel very, very, very easily. But you know what? There are times when it's good to have some laws, because we can go overboard at times. That's true. That is true. And so you realize that, say, okay, let's have some governance here. Let Longchenpa have some rules, some regulations. That's fine. I mean, the Buddhist Sanghas had rules and regulations, did they not? Yeah. Now, it doesn't have to be exactly like that or anything like that, but you know, someone is tells, look, I'd like you for you to do this. Okay. I think it'd be best if you go do this. Okay. Wonderful. Holy Spirit, if I'm traveling through fast, Holy Spirit says, I think it might be a good idea if you slow down. I say, okay, I'll slow down. And then there's a situation arises where it's good to be driving slowly, and I'm driving slowly. So the Holy Spirit is really the right governance for all of us. And the Holy Spirit appears in certain emanations, in certain ways. Grace tends to be reflected in certain ways, like in a court of a Dharma King. It can happen that way, absolutely. Sun is going down a little more, adjusting the light gain, brightness gain and exposure, adjusting it. So this is, you know, just straight talk here, very pragmatic, straight talk for the summer of 2016. Now, I've talked to various people, and they say a lot of stuff could happen this summer. They realize it. Just the average person, middle-class person, they know. They're aware that, well, the mailman, my gosh, talk to him. He's not even a middle-class person, pretty lowly person. He said, look, he says, when you have a political election and there's a lot of polarity in it, and he says, people, they don't want to spend. They don't want to take risks. They're going to wait and see what happens. He says, I've noticed this. And I said, wow, I never thought of that before. But it's true. So people get very jittery. Just before an election, when it's getting real close, they tend to get very jittery and kind of freeze up. And don't want to take any risks because they don't know how it's going to shake out. And when you get a new president in, they're also very, very leery about jumping into anything right away. They want to see how is this going to play out, you know, like that. So people are definitely very jittery here in the United States. And I think very jittery globally. Global politics is a very jittery situation right now, because especially with this election in the United States being the superpower in the world, truly, this election is pivotal for the whole planet. Absolutely pivotal. Because we're either going to choose the feminist reptilian patriarchy, or we're going to choose the old male queen bee patriarchy. You know, the basically how it's you know, go back to basically how we've been doing it before. And yeah, America will say, you know what, in order to be the great destiny that America has, we need people who are very capable of governing themselves and handling less governance. That's what it's all about here, actually. So of course you have to monitor who comes into this country. Of course you do. Of course you do. It's insanity not to, actually. It's suicide, national suicide not to do that, as we have seen. Because the you get, you know, so many people, you know, just fleeing. You know, you have to have regulated in some way, right? What are you going to do? Give these people a vote? Say, come on in. Anyone wants to come in and give them a vote? That's national suicide. Because the purpose of this country is self-governance. And so you're going to give people who have no tradition of self-governance, who don't want it at all, who don't want a vote in this country, they just sneak and give them a vote. That is crazy. It is so crazy. It's suicidal. But the more crisis there is in this country, the more the feminist reptilian patriarchs love it. They love a crisis. The present governance loves crisis. It loves fomenting crisis. Because they can say, look, you guys can't handle self-governance, can you? Well, I said, you paid a rent a mob to create a riot, and you claim that we, you know, us middle class people can't handle self governance. This is just the most slimy, underhanded, you know, tactics possible. We're not fooled by that. You pay for professional agitators and then claim we can't handle self governance. What chicanery is that? You know, what wickedness is that? It's devilish wickedness is all it is. Shame on you for trying to perpetrate such nonsense on reasonable people. So there's still a lot of people in America who are willing to try self-governance, less structure, less determinism. Because Christianity and various religions that people have here, Judaism, Hinduism, Islam, all the great traditions, have helped us go towards a less determinate point of view, okay? A less determinate point of view. All of them have helped. And so those people, they say, hey, we don't need all these, we don't need the feminist, fascist, feminist, reptilian, patriarchal structure to come in here and bust heads and put this heavy command and control structure, New World Order bureaucracy in this. We don't need that. We're okay with this less governance, less determinancy. In fact, and we're okay to go, if you're a Christian, say we're okay to follow Jesus ultimately to heaven, okay, which is this perfect indeterminacy. And, you know, we're taking a while. We're kind of a little sluggish, to, you know, say the least, stalling out, which is part of the problem, is Christianity stalled out to a large extent. Got a lot of, you know, laziness. Says, no, we want this, you know, maybe Roman Catholicism stalled out. They're going through the motions still, but you gotta make brisk progress on the path. Otherwise, you'll lapse back into old bad habits. So a lot of Protestant revivals kept Protestantism going forward, but now it's kind of stalled out too. Now you got the Tibetans saying, hey, let's go. Come on, don't stall out. So that's very welcome. I mean, any revival that says don't stall out towards indeterminism is very welcome. I don't care what label is attached to it. I don't care what figurehead is attached to it, what label is attached to it. All I care about is confidence and optimism and go, come on, let's go. And encouragement to make brisk progress. That's all I care about, because that's all that's needed is brisk progress towards evaporating our continuity fear. The labels don't matter. I don't care if someone says, well, I'm following Jesus Christ, or I'm following, you know, Longchampa, or Ramaharshi, or someone else, or Sri Sri Nandamayama, or some tradition in Islam, or whatever tradition it is. As long as there's encouragement for brisk progress towards evaporating our continuity fear, that'll lead us automatically to more and more acceptance of indeterminism, which will ultimately result in our acceptance of a new perception, perception of clear light, vision of intrinsic spaciousness. We will get that, and from there we'll feel comfortable in a pure land, call it paradise, call it whatever you want, and from there ultimately we will accept the kingdom of heaven as it is, which is perfectly indeterminate. This is guaranteed. This is how it works, for sure. So again, the labels, the figureheads and the labels don't matter at all. It's only this encouragement and confidence for brisk progress towards indeterminism, towards evaporating continuity fear. This is all that matters. That's it. I don't care about any of the other stuff. So if a rock gives me that encouragement, then that's fine. If a stone, if a river, if whatever gives me that, it's all good. That's all that's important. Now, you can say this is a pantheistic viewpoint or something, whatever you want to say. I'm not against any, whatever anyone is using to actually give them that boost and confidence and encouragement that shows up with their brisk progress, that they're very much about the business of evaporating their continuity fear. Then that's all good. It's all good. We don't need to hammer out some determinate religious structure, ultimate determinate structure, which the feminist reptilian patriarchs will say they'll give us that. We'll get a new religion and everybody will be in it. No, we don't need that, actually. If just sitting here does it, then wonderful. That's all good too. So there's a saying, truth is where you find it. I say motivation is where you find it. But of course it has to be the right, the safe path. And you can't do what they did in the 60s, the baby boomers, which is took the daredevil path, and it now we're paying the price again. So you have to have skillful means, skillful, right skillful means of making rapid progress. But the way to make the most rapid progress is full stop in the wow. Of confidence, you can just sit here and do nothing. That's the greatest, safest way, actually. So we do rule out certain things, the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, all that kind of stuff. We rule that out. Rule it out. It's a very unsafe, daredevil way of going about things. It's not impossible, but historically it's shown to have terrible backlash effects, and we're going through the worst backlash effect ever right now, which is, again, the reptilians got invited in here by the women, by the feminists, because they said, wow, we need more determinate structure. We just can't handle this. It's too much for us. Guys are going overboard. They felt the guys. Now, the guys were going overboard, yeah, but not as overboard as the feminists like to say. Just guys tend to be a little more adventurous in indeterminism. So I don't take on the guilt trip. I understand it, but the feminists overstating their case, very much overstating it, and they're not allowing for the differences. Wise women allow for the differences. They say, yeah, we can get there too. It might take us a little longer, but we can get there too. But let's not try to demonize the men who seem to be more adventurous in their indeterminism. We understand that they have less attachment to form, you know, and okay. Or we might get there at the same time, but women need to go more carefully. And so full stop in the wow is the most careful approach there is. It really is. So I invite all women to take this approach. It's the most careful approach there is. So I you know, I'm very supportive of women, always have been. And so by giving this most careful approach, this is, how could you be more helpful? How could anyone be more helpful? This is a safe, careful approach that enables you to function in your family life in every which way, but enables you to make very, very rapid progress. And I'd say it's the fastest progress. The more confidence you have that you can wow the situation, the more wow situation you can allow, the more indeterminism you can allow, because you know you can just wow it and full stop on the wow. And the guys may continue to be more adventurous in some of their, because the guys, no, you know, let me do this tantra thing and this thing and this thing. Okay, if they want to do it, fine. I don't advocate that at all. I advocate for everyone the safe approach, which ultimately turns out to be the fastest approach. It may not seem that way right off the bat, but it does. And this is a combination of rabbit and hare here. So sometimes the women may feel like we're going too fast, and sometimes they feel, oh good, they're slowing down, that's just right. And sometimes the men will feel, oh, you're slowing down too much, I want to go faster. But it's combining the rabbit and the hare, which is the most successful path, and it's the safest path. And if history tells us anything, taking the daredevil path turns out to be ruinous for the world. Ruinous. Ruinous. And we were warned this is going to be ruinous, and it turned out to be very ruinous. We don't know how ruinous it turned out to be, actually. And hopefully Longchenpa can pull our, and you know, the Dharma Kings can pull our fat out of the fire. But I don't know how much fat will be pulled out of the fire. The reptilians, the feminist reptilian patriarch, sensory perception, egomaniacs, have conspired against the United States for sure to flood the country with those who are uncomfortable with self-governance, very uncomfortable with it. So of course it's easy to get agitation against more self-governance. They don't want it. Even if they don't vote, they can agitate and protest, right? So it seems like all this, the electorate is protesting. No. Well, a lot of these people don't even have the vote. Because they're here illegally, or don't have, you know, their papers are green card, but they don't have the vote, right? They're not citizens, and yet they can show up on talk shows, and like agitating in political rallies. They can do all that stuff and give the impression that the country is really against self-governance. It gives a super false picture to the whole situation, does it not? How about this? At political rallies, you must be a citizen to attend them. Why should non-citizens who don't have a vote be allowed to give the false impression that the voters are against this position when they don't even have the right to vote? This is very, very odd, isn't it? Now, I understand that children of citizens have the right to do that, but obviously they're being groomed to be citizens from their parents who do have the right to vote, who have proven to be so, you know, used to the situation. So that's an apple and orange situation. Just because you have your green card here or you're here illegally, does that give you a right to attend political rallies? This is a very interesting question. Because it absolutely skews things. And of course, the media pays so much attention to these non-voters who are coming here simply to make as much money as possible. They're not necessarily coming here. They may claim they are, but most of them I've talked to, they have no interest in the United States if our self-governance, really. They're just here because they're making a lot of money, and their parents back home, they're sending most of their money back home to support their parents, and they're being a good daughter, a good son. But as far as the United States, I don't even really like it that much. You see, I'm not studying it, I don't get it. They're not taking civics classes, really. They're not into it. So why should they be allowed to attend political rallies and get on camera and espouse? A lot of these people on camera are not even citizens. They don't vote, they're not citizens. I mean, children are at least citizens. They're not citizens. Why should they be able to put on camera? This is propaganda, is what it is. It's very, very unfair, devious propaganda. Because most of these people really don't really care about self-governance. It's not an ideal in their mind. Some, yes. Some immigrants do come here because they're really into it. So we welcome them. We absolutely welcome them. And we make them feel welcome, too. If you see someone who's really into self-governance, you know what? I make them feel very welcome. I say, you're the kind of person we want here. But we have a right to be self-selective. But again, the power structures of this country, you know, as soon as Stanford and Harvard drop all self-selection process and allow somebody from Timbuktu, anybody who wants to come from Timbuktu, to simply enroll and be students and give them scholarships, for God's sakes, as soon as they do that, then we'll start talking, you know. We'll say, oh, okay, we'll break bread. But I don't see them doing that. So who are they to lecture us of how we're supposed to govern ourselves? And what kind of policy? I mean, these are policy wankers are telling us, you know, these think tanks give us all this policy that the politicians follow. Who are they to make policy? Okay, how about this? They allow anyone that wants to into their think tank as a fellow in their think tank. No resume, someone from Timbuktu. Okay? So does they allow the board of their think tank to be dominated by people from Timbuktu? Then we'll say, oh, okay, so you're practicing what you preach. Okay, so you're not a hypocrite. Okay, so I'll listen to you. I don't listen to hypocrites, though. You see, wasting my time. What hypocrites, you know? It's just amazing, right? So I guess they clearly think that self-governance doesn't work. Well, if they want to opt out of self-governance, why don't they leave the country? And go live in, you know, some country that doesn't believe in self-governance. And they say, well, the world's too complicated. Well, then make it less complicated. No, we can't. Yes, we can. I don't use a smartphone. I get along just fine. I know a lot of people my age don't use smartphones. They get along just fine. In fact, we get along fine writing notes and writing letters. I got no problem writing at all. I don't need all this stuff. You say, oh, well, you won't be able to function. We function just fine without all this technology, actually. In fact, we function a lot better than we do now. Wow, you just don't understand the future. Well, you don't understand the now. It's the now that's governing our goals, not the future, not time, but the now. Not determinism, but indeterminism. So you're following the path of Satan. You know, these think tank people, they're following the path of Satan. We're following the path of Christ here. So two different paths, diametrically opposite paths. We have a right to have a country, a place here, to dwell here, to follow our path. You can go follow your path somewhere else. Don't you tell us what our policy is going to be. So we absolutely have the right to think this way and to speak this way. Now, if you're having the protection, take refuge in the court of a Dharma King, you'll be protected. Okay, so I'm not afraid of speaking up this way. Obviously, there are those who don't like to hear this type of speech. Well, that's their problem. Then leave the country then. Go to a different place. The court of the Dharma King is welcome here. I welcome it here. I've accepted it here. So it's here. It's here. It's here. And we speak up for our goals, okay? We don't allow you to tell us what our goals are. We speak up for our goals. If you want to speak up for yours, fine. We give you freedom to do that. We say, okay, you're speaking up for the goal of the determinacy. Okay, you're free to pursue that goal. But we're also free to pursue the goal of indeterminacy. Okay, and this will take us to the pure lands. Absolutely it will. It will take us to freedom from death, from suffering, from aging, from everything. Freedom from all misery, ultimately. We may not choose to carry a body around for very long, or we might if we want to, but it will take us from freedom from all suffering, all misery, from all need for any health care, all of that stuff. So the idea of imposing universal health care, so whoa, that's a determinant viewpoint. Who are you to say I have to have health care? My health care is Longchenpa, I'll say. Okay? My health care is the omniscient Dharma King of indeterminacy. What do you mean I have to vaccinate? You know, all this stuff is these think tanks are imposing determinant viewpoints upon everybody. I say, the United States is not about that. The United States is we got choice. We can choose either this or that. So if you don't like having choice, leave the country. Don't stay here and tell us how we have to live. You leave the country. Because you're not a real, you're a traitor, essentially, to the purposes of this country. You're in default. So if you basically have surrendered your citizenship by demanding the country be something that it never was intended to be, so leave the country. Leave us alone. And if you don't want to leave the country, maybe we'll go to a pure land where we're free to pursue our spiritual practices, which liberate us from the false belief in determinacy. It's very simple. We're not talking about anything complex here at all. This isn't chess. You know, it's like checkers. It's black and white. Now, I have some disagreements with libertarians, which they think, oh, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, no problem, everybody should do whatever you want. No, because remember, we have a goal, we have a purpose. We're not into anarchy here at all. So the purpose is to get ultimate indeterminism, which is reality. Okay, and these bad habits prevent that. So, of course, we have some rules. So I'm not against all rules at all. Just let the Dharma Kings establish the rules for us, okay? Because some libertarians go too far, in my opinion. They absolutely go too far. Say, oh, people want to use drugs, fine. Let them use as many drugs as they want. That's no problem. Now, that's nonsense. It's a big problem. They lose the capacity to go on the path towards indeterminacy, and they end up being fascist at some point. The backlash happens. So too much unrestrictedness like this leads to a terrible backlash, which we should learn that lesson by going through the baby boomers' folly. Okay, the sex or drugs or rock and roll nonsense and the terrible backlash this has led to. If we haven't learned the lesson of history, then we're going to be doomed to repeat it again. This is crazy not to learn that lesson. So I'm just a history teacher teaching the lesson here. You won't get this in any university, will you? You're getting it here in the court of the Dharma King, aren't you, though? So all praise to the court of the omniscient Dharma King. Longchenpa, all praise, because we're getting this teaching here. This is a very essential teaching. Again, what's good about the heat? Ah, everybody comes very kind and realizes we're all in danger here. Let's help one another out. And let's not be so hasty in trying to bring about some determinate action, huh? See, I'd feel better just sitting here. This feels great. Just sitting here feels great. This is very helpful to evaporate our continuity fears. I still feel fine. I feel like I'm still a very good person. I'm just sitting here doing nothing. But I'm very focused on why I'm doing nothing, too. It's not like I'm just some drugged out, lazy person. Oh, I just, give me some more. I'll drink. And I'm just going to, just sit here and watch some television, No. We're not saying that at all. We're saying we're very purposeful here in what we're doing. Full stop in the wow. It's very purposeful. It's right spiritual practice. It's feeling, getting more and more familiar with indeterminism, of letting go of this effort towards determinism, to try and change reality. We're getting more and more comfortable with that. This is right spiritual practice, and we're making very quick progress in this way. I may be sitting here quietly, but nobody can say I'm some lazy, shiftless know-nothing, right? Obviously, that would be just an insane viewpoint. Yet they'd like to be able to say that. The feminist reptilian patriarchs would love to be able to legislate that, wouldn't they? They don't want that. Their goal is like more determinacy, more arrogance is the answer. We got to bust heads and you know, show you how great determinacy can be, and we can make more and more progress. Let's get everybody super involved in that. And these people who sitting around like this, purposefully doing nothing when they could be, that they're terrible. That's the worst thing ever. We got to re-educate them. In fact, we'll take them underground and really give them a good re-education. Who's to say these FEMA camps don't have underground, aren't connected to underground installations, actually? I don't know if anybody's ever put the dots together, right? I mean, there's massive underground installations. In fact, there's a whole system underneath the surface that has been there for a long time, since ancient times, actually, that's been rediscovered. And then a lot of new building and tunneling very fast. They're able to do a lot of it very quickly now. Who's to say there aren't tunnels that lead up lead up into these FEMA camps, right? Where you get on a train and they put you in the super fast tunnel. Apparently, these underground tunnels go incredibly fast. They use gravity levitation system, some sort of electromagnetic levitation system, and the tunnels are super straight and level, and they can travel just thousands of miles just very fast. And so you could be whisked away to some huge underground installation, quote-unquote, extermination camp from these FEMA camps. Nobody would know you disappeared, you know. There's nobody tallying that you're even in these camps. So they keep a population visible to the cameras. People say, oh, yeah, we see people there, so people are there. Okay, they're all just being re-educated there. Whereas the vast majority of maybe have whisked away underground to these extermination camps and nobody even knows it. Starting to come into focus now, what's going on here? You don't think they have the capacity to tunnel up under anywhere they want to? Of course they do. They're these nuclear-powered super tunnelers that just go through like a knife through butter. And they do have these underground train systems. There are people who have seen it. They have underground, and so all this is in place. You don't think that they can tunnel up underneath a FEMA camp? And once you're in there, nobody knows what happens to you. Keep a propaganda display of, at least, to say with jury, they kept some prisoners alive so people would think, oh, there's a work camp is all it is. Whereas, meanwhile, they were gassing them and burning them as fast as possible. And they said, what's all that smoke going up? Well, we're just burning coal or something to keep the prisoners warm. We want to treat them very humanely, so we're keeping them warm. Yeah, they lied about what they were doing. And the Germans just, you know, wanted to believe it. That they didn't want to believe that they supported governance like this. They didn't want to admit to it. Who would? Yeah, who would? You put yourself in the shoes of a German middle class person. They thought they needed heavy, you know, determinate structure governance because of the anarchy that was happening, which was purposely fomented actually, to bring this about. And so they put this governance in place. They supported. They thought it would be great. What do you think? They think they want to admit that they're gassing and burning Jews and gypsies and homosexuals and the like, undesirables. And when they say undesirable, do you think they want to admit that? No. So they'll say, what are you doing? And they say, well, we're just, you know, coal, and this is just power plant and nothing. They say, oh, okay. I mean, and they say, you see all these prisoners, and they're working, and they look fed and stuff. They say, oh, okay. You really think they're going to dig into it too much? No, they would want to believe that it's just all kosher, and, you know, everything's okay. Human nature, same thing likely to happen going forward here. The model there, they already know the model. They've refined it. And they keep some healthy, well-fed prisoners around that are visible public, so people look and see, oh, yeah, everybody seems to be well-fed and cared for medically and stuff. There's no problem there. They don't want to know about it. They don't want to believe that they supported this and helped put this in place. So I know German people were blamed for it all in some level, you know, that, but the trick was that they got, you know, stampeded into it because of fomenting crises was the first step. Foment riots, foment financial collapse, foment crisis. And then they say, oh my gosh, we this is terrible. We need someone to bring back law and order. And then they jump right into a fascistic, reptilian, you know, dominance type of head-busting situation, which was certainly the Nazis, certainly that way, which was really a coalition with the Fraulein feminists. Absolutely it was. Because they, again, they want more determinism for the kinder, the children, you know, right? We want really good schools. We want the kinder to go through these really good schools and learn all about determinism. It's such a wonderful thing. We're doing God's work here. Yeah, right. Doing the devil's work. So that's how it happened in Germany. This is how it's happening in the United States. Same old, same old, same old, except slicker here. A lot slicker. Slicker technologies at work here. They're going underground. A lot of it's going to be done underground. Germans actually started pioneering that, the Nazis. A lot of underground installations, they were working on it. But we've, you know, it's been perfected now, the whole thing about underground installations and stuff. The way they're doing it. And the propaganda is slicker. The media is slicker. People are fatter and more willing to just, I don't want to be bothered by it. And the crisis they can foment is probably going to be a worse crisis. Banking collapse. Very likely a severe banking collapse. We'll see what happens. They could easily do that right now. They could easily do that. And you really think that the feminist reptilian patriarchal sensory perception egoic maniacs, you really think they wouldn't do that? They did 9/11. You don't think they'd bring about a bank collapse, bring about a crisis? You bet your life they would do it. They don't have any compunction at all. They'd say, this is what we need, this is what we're going to do. This is, it helps out determinism. This is a good excuse. We need an excuse. Here's the excuse. Excuses, black flags are used throughout history. It's very, very, very common. Reichstag fire for the Nazis, right? Various things are used to foment then you know, a crisis that is used to get people to support heavy-handedness. So of course this is on their docket. Absolutely it is. Now whether this will be prevented or not, we'll see. The potential and the plans are certainly there. I'm aware of that. The structure of the structured plan of a bank collapse is certainly in place, and they can pull the plug easily. And you know, will it happen or not? There's of course great efforts to not let it happen. We can back away from that edge, and we'll see what happens. Just our effort to bring it to light and see it helps prevent it, actually, because in consciousness we may say, hey, you know, I don't think we really need that. We got this spiritual practice. It's very easy and very safe. We can go to full stop in the wild practice. We don't really back away from the edge. We can evaporate our continuity fear safely. So there is a safe way to do it. So we don't need to listen to knuckleheads who says the spiritual path is so dangerous. Oh, it's so terrible. It ruins, it wrecks us. Oh, we need a heavy, determined structure. Make sure we never go down that path again. So we don't need to listen to the feminist, you know, fascist feminist patriarchal reptilians. We don't need their governance. We don't need their governance. Thanks, but no thanks. Don't need you. We can in our back away from that edge of that cliff. We absolutely can. If people realize there's a safe spiritual practice. Very, very safe. And I've pioneered it. I've shown it's very safe. Very, very doable for everyone. Not entirely easy. It's stressful. It's difficult, but it's very safe. Very, very safe. So, again, anyone who really wants to do it can do it. And we can go at our own pace, actually, too. And we can evaporate our continuity fear. Absolutely, we can. Of course, we do need to go briskly. But within that caveat, we can take this path safely. And the Dharma Kings look out for us. We can put them in charge of our path and say, look, take me through this safely. Show me how to do it safely. Longchenpa will show us how to do it safely. He's a perfect master of that. He's not into trying to create some sort of backlash through unsafe ways. Not at all. Look at the disaster this has caused. So, this is all good news here. It's like fabulous, great, good news here. On this, you know, wonderfully toasty day. Now, I don't know how it is in the rest of California, but I can bet it's mighty toasty in Palm Springs, which is great. Great, if you're in Palm Springs right now, just take it easy, huh? Back off of all this determinate endeavor. Say, hey, maybe God doesn't want me to. You say, you know what? I don't think God wants me to work on determinism in this heat. That's a nice step right there, isn't it? And then you say, maybe God doesn't want me to work on determinism at all. Maybe I just made this whole fantasy up to try to be separate from God and create my own reality so I could say, I'm prime creator. Maybe it's just a play, a whim of arrogance that I'm engaged with. Maybe, right? But I can tell you one thing right now, so doggone hot, I don't think God wants me to really work on determinism. He's at very least, he's saying, take a break, you know? All right, well, that's a step in the right direction, isn't it? God gives breaks from it. And gradually you redefine what God really is. Gradually we start realizing, hey, maybe God doesn't want us to even try to establish determinism at all. We're free to try, but God's not saying, this is what I created you for. Not at all. So did God create us human beings? We said, well, maybe he did not. Maybe he created me as a spirit. And as Jesus said, I am spirit, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And he said, hey, maybe I can listen to the real Jesus gospel, instead of the religious Jesus. Maybe I can actually do that. And maybe you start doing it a little bit. Maybe start listening and hearing and practicing full stop in the wow. Because you say, just from that heat, you say, ah, that heat, you know, I think it's okay. God understands. Yeah, we're capable of that. So, you know, knock yourself out in Palm Springs and just sit there. Knock yourself out by just sitting there and doing nothing. Because I think it's probably at 115 there today. That's hot. I've been there, done that. It's great. The hotter the better. So I said, wow. Of course, I still played golf, but you know what? I allowed myself to sit in the shade and with ice on my head and say, ah, it was great. I hit the ball. This is a great practice. Because in golf, you're supposed to keep going. Come on, pace of play, keep playing. I said, oh, no. I said, I hit the ball, you know. Let the ball sit there. God understands. I don't have to come out with a determinate outcome anyway. It's too hot. Forget it. I'm not going to play this hole. I was going to sit in the shade here for a while. And it is wonderful to break that habit of pursuing determinism, competitive determinism, or even non-competitive determinism, right? And if I feel like it, I'll wander back out and hit it again, but you know, hey, I'm not going to try to line up this putt. You know, it's like 113, 14 degrees. I'm just going to like hit the ball, get it close, tap it in, let's go to the next one. I don't really care what my score is. It's too hot to care about what your score is. It's very, very helpful, actually. And, of course, the other extreme cold can be used in the same way. I'm not going to go out from this tent. Too doggone cold. I'm not going to go, you know, manufacture cars. You know, it's too cold. I'm just going to sit here and I'm going to meditate, actually. I'm going to go in a cave and meditate. I'm not coming out of this cave. It's too cold. You can do the same thing. I'm not coming out of this cave. It's too hot. I'm not going to worry about trying to build a better mousetrap. You know, forget it. I'll do that tomorrow. Maybe, I don't think God really is telling me I have to build a better mousetrap today. Maybe tomorrow he'll tell me that, but not right now. So you start cutting yourself some slack, and you start opening up, practice full stop on the wow, and you start opening up into truth, and truth starts becoming self-evident to us. Truth is actually self-evident. We don't have to find it. It's within us and becomes more and more self-evident to us as we go along. So this has turned out to be a wonderful video. Enjoyed it so much. I didn't know how it would turn out. It's not easy to stay in this mood, this ambience as we go forward. People are very jittery. Rightfully so, because they say, you know, our future could radically change, actually. It could change into the hand of radicals for good, at least for a long time. The radical, fanatical, fascist, feminist, patriarchal reptilians. Boy, marriage made in hell right there. Who worshiping sensory perception and determinacy as their god. They're bad news. They're really bad news. I mean, you couldn't have any worse news than that. And that news could be coming really soon. Full on, full blast here, full blast. Maybe even sooner than we realize.